To the Good Eggs of History podcast. Here we explore the more unknown historical rule breakers, the rebels, the brave, and the bonkers. I'm Hannah Shackle, and I'll take you on a journey to discover these absolute badasses. Today we'll be talking about Joan Jurdie, a 17th century woman who was accused of witchcraft not once, but twice. Nick Crouch will be joining me, and he has researched her story in depth and contributed to numerous articles about her life. Imagine a small but prosperous agricultural settlement close to Doncaster in South Yorkshire. The land poured forth with fish, game, and produce vital to the nearby town. It sounds like a bucolic idyll full of people happily working the land together and living peaceful but small lives. However, this was not the case. This small community experienced witch trials over a number of years, revealing deep rifts between families. The record for Joan Jurdie and her family isn't very extensive, but we know her husband must have been of some standing in Rossington. Joan acted in the role of a healer for the area, somebody who you'd go to if you had any ailments, or even if your animals did. She will have had great knowledge of what herbs to use to help ease your symptoms, and undoubtedly her expertise will have helped those around her. Sadly, this seems to have been a common occupation for those accused of witchcraft. In 2021, Dr. Nicola Ring from the Edinburgh Napier University, with midwifery lecturer Nessa McHugh and child health nursing tutor Rachel Davidson Welsh, found strong connections between early nursing and midwifery practices and witchcraft trials. It often seems to be the case of literally damned if you do, damned if you don't. If these women gave salves, drinks or poultices that didn't work on the sick, the families were accused of them having done it on purpose. And if the person was cured, they were accused of having knowledge that could only have been acquired from the devil.
What was the atmosphere like in 17th century England in regards to witchcraft, superstition, sorcery, that kind of thing?
Everybody believes in it. You don't come across much that's really calling its existence into question. The king, the new king, King James, who's come from Scotland, where they're kind of really into their witch trials, and where he's already instituted a witch hunt because he believes himself to have been targeted by witchcraft. He's come to England and he's immediately passed a new set of laws about witchcraft, which are the basis for English law on this until 1735. And is also the basis of the law that was being used to prosecute Salem witches.
In 1605, Joan Jurdie was asked to attend the birth of Jeanette Murfin's child, as all local women were expected to do. For an unrecorded reason, she didn't attend, and nor did she go to share the traditional labour cake at the labour cake party. However, following a visit 2 days later from Joan, Jeanette fell ill, and suspicion began to bubble up. The townsfolk approached the mayor with their accusations, with Anne Judd, Jeanette's sister, claiming that Joan told her that Jeanette was not at the worst. She will be worst yet. This was thought to be a threat, and Anne added that Jeanette had told her that she was ridden with a witch. Then Catherine Dolphin informed them that Jeanette said, "She hath killed me. I may never recover." During the trial, it was shown that Dolphin had previously sought help from Joan, who had helped cure her ailing child. And Joan cured animals also, helping an ill calf to recover, though Catherine claimed Joan had made three of her own animals die.
They would have taken these things like animals passing away. Obviously, in the case of Joan, women and children passing away, they would have taken all of these as like very significant signs of harm being done to them and their household.
Well, certainly. I mean, infant death was a common thing. And, you know, clearly livestock were falling ill and dying all the time. But there clearly were cases where people felt very strongly that this was unnatural. And that it wasn't to be expected, and someone must be to blame. I mean, one thing that does come through in the testimony about given about Joan Jurdie is that she's plainly a very sharp-tongued woman. She just doesn't hold back and says things that are subsequently construed as giving, if you like, knowledge of the future and... in some cases, it's knowledge of the future of, you know, in the case of this particular child, I mean, she does say, well, you know, things are going to get worse before they get better. And of course, when they do get worse, it's taken as evidence that she wished it worse.
Luckily, the judge ruled that she was innocent, though this didn't lay the matter to rest. 3 years later, the townsfolk came forward alleging she was a witch once more. This time it was a triple murder of Hester and Jane Dolphin and George Murfin, all of whom were associated with the previous trial.
The second set of accusations was actually around another three children who died, and one of them was a Dolphin and two of them the Murfins again. You know, there definitely was a kind of split there in the village.
Mm.
She was lost to records after that, and people had assumed that she was another sad example of circumstantial evidence and local paranoia. But in 2021, Nick Crouch found death records that proved she lived another 20 years. She was extraordinarily lucky in the fact that her husband was alive. Two-thirds of women accused of witchcraft at the time were widows, and could therefore bring his influence and sway to court.
And the victims, for the most part, are widows. They're people who live in the community, but they have no protectors. Very often they're reduced to begging. Not street begging, but these are people who go from door to door asking for food, offering to do a little bit of work, and in winter particularly begging to have a place near the fire. So they're kind of in the household, but they're not of the household.
Yeah.
And it makes them very vulnerable to accusations of all sorts. So very often it actually starts with accusations of theft.
I see.
But then, you know, a baby falls sick, a piglet dies, you know, and all of a sudden they're saying, well, she was in the house at the time.
Yeah.
She must be a witch.
Did she stay in the community after both of these accusations?
Yes. Yes, she did. As I say, she's not a widow. We don't know very much about her husband, Leonard Jurdie. He's clearly someone of some substance.
Mm-hmm.
He dies a few years after her. In fact, in an accident involving a horse. So he's rich enough to have a horse.
Okay.
And in fact has been on his horse into Doncaster that day to do some business. So, you know, he sounds like a man of affairs. They've got a maid who gives testimony to the grand jury. And she has a son who's a teenager about the time of the accusations. And probably she has a daughter as well. Women tend to disappear out of the formal records if they get married in a parish that isn't their own, because they just disappear and change their names. But the son had three children. Parish records show that Jurdie lived long enough to know all three of her grandchildren. And I kind of suspect that a lot of this is really represents a bit of a power struggle between Catherine Dolphin and Jurdie over status.
Interesting.
It is particularly interesting to note that Catherine Dolphin clearly wants it to be known that her husband is someone of status. Her husband is a husband man.
Yes.
And you think, that means that he's not a labourer. You know, he's a man who works his own plot of land, but isn't really a very high status. You know, it's not as high as being able to say you're a yeoman, let alone to say esquire or something like that after your name. But it just speaks of someone who's kind of grasping at small elements of status.
How we are now, we hear, I mean, the phrase witch hunters become shorthand nowadays. And so whenever you hear the words like witch trials, you think of all these things, but kind of when you get down to it, and obviously there's a bit of conjecture involved, it's, you know, people who are hurting for children that they've lost in very small communities where it will have such a big impact.
No, absolutely.
Even those who don't know a lot about history know about witch trials. When we think of witch trials, we think of witnesses convulsing in the stand, pointing accusatory fingers. We think of hearing demonic voices of cursed animals dying in droves, and poor wrongly accused women pleading for mercy. And we certainly don't imagine any outcome other than execution. Before Nick found the records proving she survived, it was another sad story to add to the many women who hadn't escaped with their own lives. But his findings are a heartwarming end to her story. Joan Jurdie is a good egg because she obviously held her own against these accusations and had the courage to stay in a town where she clearly had those who held grudges against her and wished her active harm. I don't know about you, but I don't think I'd be strong enough to weather that storm. But Joan was evidently made of very strong stuff.
Thank you for listening. I'm Hannah Shackle. If you'd like to join in the conversation, join me on Instagram at Hannah Shackle. Hotel Alpha November November Alpha Hotel. Sierra Hotel Echo Kilo Lima Echo. I love me some NATO alphabet. There'll be photos, behind the scenes, sneak peeks and more. Please join me next time to enjoy the next Good Egg.